Hello everyone. Let's talk about Lophophorids today. Two phyla of mostly marine animals, Bryozoa and Brachiopoda, are characterized by a lophophore, a circular or U-shaped ridge around the mouth bearing one or two rows of ciliated tentacles into which the coelom extends. The lophophore functions as a surface for gas exchange, and the cilia of the lophophore serve to guide the organic detritus and plankton on which the animal feeds to the mouth. Because of the lophophore, bryozoans and brachiopods have been considered related to one another, but some recent data indicate that the structures may have evolved convergently. Brachiopods share some features with protostomes and others with deuterostomes. Cleavage in both brachiopods and bryozoans is mostly radial, as in deuterostomes. The formation of the coelom varies. In phoronids, the mouth forms from the blastopore, whereas in the rest of brachiopods and in the bryozoans, it forms from the end of the embryo opposite the blastopore. Molecular evidence aligns lophophorates with protostomes. Because of the discrepancy between anatomical and developmental characters and molecular characters, the phylogeny of these animals continues to be a fascinating puzzle. Bryozoans are aquatic colonies of tiny individuals which typically secrete a protective skeleton. They are sessile, mainly marine and occur from tide level down to abyssal depths. They are encrusting or freely branching, common today and abundant as fossils. Their common name, moss animals, is a direct translation of the Latin word, bryozoa. The bryozoan colony contains many interconnecting individuals. The skeleton may be chitinous, but is calcareous in those species commonly occurring as fossils. The colony shows a range in form and size. It may be encrusting, stick-like, massive, or a delicate branching network. Usually, it measures only a few centimeters across, but it may exceed 1 meter. It consists of tubular or box-like chambers, which have an aperture at one end and are rarely more than 1 millimeter in length. Superficially, the zooid resembles a tiny coral polyp, but the body is relatively complex, generally similar in plan to that of the brachiopods. The mouth is surrounded by a ring or crescent-shaped lophophore bearing ciliated tentacles. It leads to a U-looped digestive tract ending in an anus, which opens near the mouth but outside the tentacles. During feeding, the tentacles are extended to filter microorganisms from the water. At rest, they are retracted within the body. In some cases, the zooids are modified for special functions. Fenestella. The colony is fan or cup-shaped, arising from a calcified basal holdfast. It consists of a network of delicate subparallel branches which bifurcate occasionally and are linked at regular intervals by crossbars. The zooecia are short tubes bound together in calcareous tissue in which circular apertures form two rows along one side of each of the branches. Living bryozoa adhere to seaweeds, shells or stones, and their form may be modified by turbulence. They are found mainly in clear, shallow water, but will tolerate muddy conditions and have been found at abyssal depths. They are common in coral reefs, which encrusting forms help to bind. Fossil bryozoa occur most abundantly in limestones. They may also be found in shales, but rarely in sandstones. The massive forms are often well preserved, but the more delicate lesiozoaria tend to be fragmentary. The Bryozoa range from the early Ordovician to the present day. They are abundant at many horizons and remain a flourishing group. A variety of forms are short-ranged, widely distributed, and accordingly valuable for purpose of correlation. Bryozoa were already diverse and widespread in the lower Ordovician, suggesting a prior, unrecorded history of development. The predominant lower Paleozoic forms were massive or stem-like. They played an important part in reef formation. Most Paleozoic orders did not survive the Permian, but two groups, inconspicuous in the Paleozoic, ranged on through the Mesozoic and Cenozoic to the present day. A new order with rounded box-like Zoesia and the orifice closed by a hinged lid appeared in the lower Cretaceous. Some were encrusting, others formed delicate branching stems of fronds. They were abundant and highly diverse in the upper Cretaceous and the dominant forms in the present day. The brachiopods are sessile marine animals which secrete an external shell consisting of two dissimilar but equilateral valves. The plan of symmetry bisects the valves in an anterior-posterior direction. The group is of minor importance today, but fossil brachiopods are abundant and varied in Paleozoic and Mesozoic rocks. The shell may be calcareous of chitinous and is secreted by the mantle, which consists of two extensions of the body wall, one from the dorsal side and one from the ventral side of the body. The two valves are thus dorsal and ventral in position relative to the body. The brachiopod is attached to the seafloor at its posterior end, usually by a stalk, the pedicle. The body lies in the posterior part of the shell, and from it, the mantle lobes extend forward to enclose a space, the mantle cavity, much of which is occupied by the lophophore, a feeding device which collects suspended particles. There is a well-developed coelom. The nervous and circulatory systems are not highly organized. Brachiopod shells range in size from a few millimeters to as much as 30 centimeters in width in the case of the carboniferous form. The opening on the ventral side of the body is known as the pedicle valve, since the pedicle commonly emerges through it. The valve on the dorsal side, the brachial valve, takes its name from the brachia, the arm-like projections of the lophophore which it carries. The valves open slightly along the anterior margin during feeding. The anterior two-thirds of the mantle cavity is taken up by the lophophore. This is fleshy and may be a lobed disc, or two coiled or folded arms called brachia, each of which has a groove leading to the mouth and is fringed with ciliated filaments. The cilia, by beating, maintain currents of water along three paths, a median outgoing flow and an intake flow on either side. Most brachiopods are attached by a pedicle which is fixed to the pedicle valve by the adjuster muscles. Its distal end adheres to a rock or shell. The opening and closing of the valves are controlled by a system of muscles which are attached to the inner surface of the valves toward the posterior end, where they may leave muscle scars. The muscle system is simplest in the articulate brachiopods, consisting commonly of a pair of adductor muscles which run across the shell cavity from the interior of the pedicle valve to the interior of the brachial valve, and of two pairs of deductor muscles which turn obliquely from the pedicle valve to a projection, the cardinal process from the hinge line to the brachial valve. Both sets of muscles work by contracting. In the articulate brachiopods, the shell is calcareous. A thin chitinous layer overlies the shelly part, which is made of two layers of calcite crystal. In some articulate groups, the shell is punctate, being perforated by fine tubules, while in other groups, the shell lacks these tubules and it's impunctate. The brachiopod shell grows by increments, which typically are greater along the lateral margins and which form concentric growth lines on the outer surface. Thus, the initial shell remains at or near the posterior margin and may form the tip of a pointed beak. The shell surface may be smooth or bear an ornament which is useful in distinguishing species. The deltherium is a triangular gap in the posterior margin of the pedicle valve, leaving a circular hole, the foramen, for the passage of the pedicle. The hinge apparatus consists of two teeth in the pedicle valve that fit into two sockets in the brachial valve. Orthids, the first articulates to appear, represent the ancestral stock for later groups. The shell and impunctate, they appear in the lower Cambrian and are numerous and varied in the Ordovician and Silurian. Articulate brachiopods are typically found in temperate and cold waters. Terebratulina, for instance, is found in shallow seas around the North Atlantic coastline. It may occur down to about 1,400 meters, but its commonness between 100 and 200 meters. Terebratulina belongs to the Terebratulida, the last order of brachiopods to appear. Brachiopods appeared in the early Cambrian. Their numbers increased greatly during the lower Paleozoic to a maximum in the Silurian and Devonian, and then declined gradually during the upper Paleozoic. Only a few stocks survived into the Mesozoic, during which two groups were common, especially in the Jurassic. They were less important in the Tertiary and today are a minor group. In the early Cambrian, brachiopods were already established and diverse. The orthids were joined in the mid-Cambrian by one order. Further radiation in the Ordovician brought greater variety with the appearance of three additional orders, and numbers and variety rose to a maximum in the Silurian and early Devonian. Brachiopods are stratigraphically important in the shelly fasces of the Paleozoic. The two phyla of Lophophorates probably share a common ancestor, and they share a mixture of protostome and deuterostome characteristics. The lophophore is a characteristic feeding and gas exchange structure with ciliated tentacles. Bryozoans are exclusively colonial, whereas brachiopods and phoronids are solitary. Brachiopods have two shells with dorsal and ventral valves, not lateral. That is for today. Thanks for watching. See you next time.